You know, you can hurt a lot of people. You can hurt yourself, but you certainly can hurt the people around you with an incorrect view of God. If you have the wrong view of God, it's just a dangerous spot to be in. As a pastor, I feel the weight of that, probably I would imagine as much as anyone. In fact, when I was telling a few friends of mine that I was doing this series called What God Is Really Like, they said, who do you think you are to do a series like that? And it does feel bold, audacious to say, hey, listen, this is what God is like. But as we said last week, this series is not really about what I think about God. It's not really about what you think about God. That we're rallying around this one particular parable that Jesus told, where he described, hey, if you want to know what God is like, here's what he's like. And as we as we talked about last week, I gave you this illustration that was really an after the rose illustration. I don't do a lot of illustrations from The Bachelorette, but we did one last week where we talked about one person that said, you know what? I believe I can do anything I want to do and God still loves me. And another said, how dare you? You should not laugh. You shouldn't joke around about your sin like that. And in a lot of ways, they had hurt each other. And they both had about half things true of God. And because of that, it had the potential to do damage. And so I hope you caught week one where we talked about the father in this story. Today, we're gonna talk about the younger brother. Next week, we're gonna talk about the older brother. And so if you listen to today and you go, well, that's only half true, you gotta come back for the older brother, because the story Jesus tells about the older brother is just as astonishing is the one about the younger brother. But last week, as we said, this is really the statement we're trying to build around, that how we think about God matters. It matters. It matters what you think about God. Primarily, it matters what you think about God because it matters what you think about when you think about what God thinks about you. And that's a lot of thinkabouts right there. But what you think about God really does matter. But maybe even more than that, it matters because it determines what you think he thinks about you. And it's tough to get life right when we've got God wrong. It's just hard to get life right. It's hard to treat other people the way we'd want to treat other people. It's hard to live the kind of life we want to live if we've got God wrong. And so I hope over the next couple of weeks, we all grow together in getting God a little more right so that we can get life a little more right. I want to take a quick moment to tell you a story up front that I hope will set the stage for the conversation today. But this is a drone remote control. Last Christmas, our then 7-year-old, when we said, hey, what do you want for Christmas? He said, well, I want a drone. I don't know what kind of presents you got when you were a kid, but I was like, what about like a bicycle or something like that, you know? He was like, no, I want a drone. And my wife and I, we've got 5 little kids, and he's our second child. And we don't have that kind of money to just be buying our kids a drone. But my in-laws do. And so when they said, hey, what could we get your kids for Christmas? We said, well, Jake, our 7-year-old, he wants a drone. And they didn't bat an eye at it. They were like, oh, wow, this is going to be great. Maybe he's going to be a pilot or an astronaut or something like that. I was like, I'm hoping he'll pass second grade, but that's cool too. So they got him a drone. And they came in town. They live in Texas. And so they came in town for the weekend before Christmas. And we celebrated Christmas with them and opened up all the presents. And so he opened it up and he was so excited to get the drone. And so we go to the little the field next to the elementary school around the corner from our house. And that afternoon, we go out to give it a little test drive, give it a spin, see what it'll do. And he went first because it was his present, despite the fact that all of his siblings wanted to go as well. And he starts flying it. And he was very cautious with it, appropriately careful. And he'd fly it up a couple feet, and then he was trying to work on his landing, and so it kind of slam into the ground. And so I said, hey, buddy, give me that thing. Let me give it a whirl. And so I decided I was going to take this thing and let it see what it would really do. I said, you know, I've read the specs on this. This thing will supposedly go really high up in the air, like hundreds of yards up in the air. I said, watch this. So I flew the thing and got it up pretty high. And as it got a little higher, I started noticing that my depth perception was not as reliable as I was thinking it was going to be. Because I would be moving the thing around and I couldn't tell, am I bringing it closer to me or is it getting further away? I will also say, to my defense, there was a lot of wind that day. And so as it got up in the air, the wind started blowing it away. And the more I tried to control it, the less I felt like I was able to do. And eventually the thing started flying further and further away, which wouldn't have been that bad except for my son grabbing my pants, continuing to pull on them, going, "Dad, what are you doing?" What made it worse is that my father-in-law was standing there, and he knows better than to know that I should be trusted with something like this. He's watched me for the last 13 years, so I don't think any of this was a surprise to him. But the further it got away, the more I realized I don't really have as much control over this thing as I think I do. And within 30 seconds, this thing had crossed a line of trees, and we couldn't even see it anymore. To this day, I still don't know where it landed. So some of you gave your child a drone for Christmas last year without a remote control. I'd love to make an exchange with you, and I'll give you the remote for it. It was a pretty miserable day for me to realize that I had lost the present that they gave to our child. And I bring that story up for one, just to give just a moment of self-deprecation, but to number two. Because we all know what it feels like to lose something. We all know what it feels like to be lost, worse than that. Some of you have stories when you were a kid, where you were at the mall, or you were at a sporting event, or you were out in a crowd, or at a parade, or at a festival, and you lost your parents, and you went through that miserable feeling of going, oh no, what's gonna happen to me? That feeling of being lost is a terrible, terrible feeling. But maybe what's even worse is when we're the ones to blame, when we're the ones that have made the decisions to get us into the place that we're in, and we just don't know, is it ever gonna be the same again? Am I ever going to be able to come back home? Am I ever going to be able to get life back on the tracks? Am I ever going to be able to have that relationship again? It's a pretty terrible feeling. And it's in that context that Jesus told the story that we're looking at for the next couple of weeks. He started in Luke 15 by saying, hey, there were these sinners and tax collectors that were so excited about the fact that Jesus was hanging with them, that he was talking with them, that he had a relationship with them because they were the social outcasts. And the religious leaders of the day, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, they muttered, as we talked about last week, they muttered and they said, who does this man think he is? How dare he to eat with sinners and tax collectors? And it was in that context that Jesus told a couple of stories. First, he told a story about a woman who had 10 coins and had lost one of her coins. And despite the fact that she still had 9, she turned her house upside down to find the one that she had lost. And then he told a story about a shepherd that had 100 sheep, and 99 of them were safe and sound, but there was one that was lost. And the shepherd went to great lengths to go find the one that was lost, even forsaking the 99 that he still had, just to go and find that one lost sheep. But Jesus raises the stakes, not talking about a coin, not talking about a shepherd. No, then he tells the final story in Luke 15, the story of a father who lost a son. And that's the context that we pick up the story today. This is known as the parable of the prodigal son, the parable of the prodigal son. And again, today, last week we dealt with the father. Today we're talking about the younger brother. Next week we're gonna talk about the older son, because the story's not complete without understanding all of them in their entirety. As I was really trying to study and research and understand this passage, I bumped into a painting that I had seen a long time ago, but hadn't seen in a while. Does anyone know who painted this painting right here? Me, this was me. Just something I did on my, no. This was a Rembrandt. I kind of thought more people would shout that out. I didn't know either though that this was a Rembrandt. But next time you see it, now you can go, oh my goodness, a Rembrandt. I love Rembrandt. You just feel more sophisticated, more highbrow, you know, pinky in the air, if you know what I'm talking about, if you know something like that. So this is actually, this was titled The Return of the Lost Son, or The Return of the Prodigal Son. And he finished this painting, probably historians think about 2 years before he passed away in 1669. And there's so much emotion in this painting because there's so much emotion in the story. But a lot of people think that Rembrandt poured his heart, poured his soul into this work because of how personally he felt connected to the story that we're gonna look at today. And so I thought I would just have this painting just sitting here on the screen in case you maybe lose interest in what I'm saying, then dive into the details of this painting because it's beautifully done. It's emotional by nature. You see the father, you see the younger son who's returned in the background. You see probably the mother. We see the older brother whose hands are crossed. And then this gentleman over here maybe is some kind of overseer or steward or financial advisor to the family. But an amazingly beautiful painting that just gives us a little bit of perspective of what this story is really all about. So here's the way the story goes, Luke 15, verse 11. Jesus continued after telling this two stories. He says, there was a man who had two sons. Now, I got to remind you, the point of this story is not that God is like a father who has this unconditional love for the younger brother. No, as we said last week, who is this message? Who is this parable directed toward? It was directed toward the chief, the priests, the religious leaders. It was directed toward the Pharisees. It was directed toward the leaders of the church, the leaders of the synagogue. He's directing it to them saying, hey, moral insiders, listen to me. You're blind in how you see God. You're narrow in how you see God. You're self-righteous in the way you think you have it all right. But your incorrect view of God, your half-true view of God is destroying both your own soul, but it's also affecting the people's lives around you. Is God this father, as we see in this parable, is he this father who has this unconditional love for this younger brother? Well, yes, that is who he is, but that's not the whole point of this story. No, there were two sons. There were two sons, but today we're just gonna look at the one of them. There was a man who had two sons, and the younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. And so he divided his property between them. This son comes to his father, and we can't even understand what this would be like because we don't think of inheritance in the same way. Maybe you grew up in a family, maybe you are in a family unit that thinks about it in this way. And maybe you could imagine it more than others could, but most people just don't see it in this way. But this younger brother came to the dad and said, essentially, Dad, it would be better off if you were dead. Dad, I wish you would just die. I'm done with you. I don't need you. I don't want a relationship with you. I want what you have. He chafed at the idea of having to enjoy the family assets under the supervision of his father. He wanted to make his own decisions. He wanted to have full control of his portion of the wealth. And so he chucks a deuce to his dad, to his family, to the home, and he sets out on his own with his portion of the family's wealth. Not long after that, Jesus says, the younger son got together all he had, which all he had was only what had been given to him from his father. And he set off for a distant country, and there he squandered his wealth in wild living. And after he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. Now, over the last couple of months, I've probably read this story maybe 15 times. And every time I've read it, I thought, why did Jesus include that little detail about the famine? In fact, the first time when I reread this a couple of months ago, I had forgotten about the famine. I thought, I forgot that there was a famine in this land. Why did Jesus include that detail? Why a famine? Why mention the famine? I mean, it could have just been that he set off in a distant country and he squandered all of his wealth with wild living. It could have just been that, but he said, no. He did that, but then there was a circumstance that was outside of his control that ultimately caused him to hit rock bottom. But that really squares up with life though, doesn't it? That really maps with the way life works, doesn't it? Yeah, he made some decisions that maybe didn't help him, but he, like us, we have that same thing in us that thinks, well, I can control the circumstances. I can control the consequences. I can handle the consequences. I'll be all right. I can handle. How many times have you said, I know this might seem like this is out there, but I got this. I got this. I'm good. I can handle it. And then something outside of your control, outside of my control, reminds us that we don't actually have it. And the severe famine caused him to hit the bottom. So you only hit rock bottom when you have no other choices, when you're left with no other choices. I called a friend of mine this week who runs an addiction recovery program. And I said, hey, I was thinking about you this week as I was studying this passage a little bit more. Tell me about rock bottom. He said, well, rock bottom only happens when you've got nowhere else to go. He said, if the people that come and see us have any other place to go, they would have. They only come to us when it's their last option. And so they're not exactly always wanting to rehabilitate. They're not exactly even at the point where they would admit they have a problem, but they have no other place to go. And that's where this younger son got because of the famine. And what's sad is that there's something about the supervision, the provision of the father, that if he would have just stayed under his provision, stayed under his supervision, he didn't have to get there. The famine, I would assume, hit just like it hit the distant land. It probably also hit the father's estate as well. But the workers that were employed by the father, they were still eating. They were still living indoors. Everything was going okay for them. Because they were under the supervision, they were under the provision of the father. But it got so bad for this young man that he went out and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to his field to feed pigs. We don't have time to dive into how repulsed this crowd would have been culturally by this statement, that someone in a Jewish society like this would have had to go feed the pigs. It would have been despicable. It would have been embarrassing for the family, embarrassing for the parents. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. And the harsh reality of his decisions had caught up with him. His longing for freedom had gotten him into this. But as we see in his story, just like we know in ours, there's just no such thing as ultimate freedom. There's just no such thing as this independent life that we want. This self-autonomous, self-directed, independently wealthy. I make my own decisions. I'm not accountable to anyone. No, as we're going to find in this younger brother's story, that the greatest independence that we find is found being dependent on the Father. The greatest independence that we can have is found when we're dependent on the one who owns it all, the one who invites us to call him Father. But before we dive into what happened next, I want to just stop here and ask you a question that really is about all of us. This is, might not be about you personally, but it might be about all of us. Why do so many of us have a tendency to run? Why do we have this thing in us that wants to run? It's in every single one of us. I mean, yes, as we unveil the older brother next week, some of you are going to go, oh, I relate to the older brother more. Some of you are the kind of person that maybe you actually are an older brother, an older sister, and you're a rule abider. You stick to the rules. I see some of you nodding now. You've stayed close to home. Maybe you work for the family business. You run the family business. You've done the right thing. You look at people that have gone off to a distant land like Los Angeles or New York or maybe even Atlanta for some, and you go, what are you looking for? You're not going to find it. Whatever it is you're looking for, you're probably not going to find it, but you just stay close to home and you do the right thing and you work hard. Some of you, that's your perspective of religion as well. In fact, for most people, religion is there's a God and you do the right thing. And if you do, he's cool with you. That's religion for most people. There is a God and he wants you to do the right thing, so do it. But others of you, you just go, no, I don't want to do that. That sounds like no fun. That sounds boring, which is why some of you have gone off to a distant land or are on the way there now, because you think that just sounds boring. Or maybe some of you think, you know what? I had an older sibling and my older sibling set such a high standard. I just thought, you know what? I'm not gonna be able to reach that. And so I'm just gonna go, I gotta go do me. I'm gonna go do my own thing. I'm gonna go figure it out myself. And whether I find it or not, I can't do it that way. Ultimately though, here's what I want to talk about for the next few minutes, that ultimately, when we don't understand the love of the Father, every single one of us is tempted to run away from home. When we don't understand who God really is, every one of us is tempted to leave the home. I was sitting about a year ago at a Chick-fil-A really early in the morning. In fact, me and this other guy were there waiting on it to open up. As a pastor, I find myself in these really odd situations. I have a couple of degrees in theology, and none of them train me for what you actually do as a pastor, which is unfortunate. This guy I had never met before, and so it was one of those awkward, like, hey, are you so-and-so? Yeah, are you? Yeah, I am. Okay, good to meet you. I'm glad that we're here waiting on them to open it up. And so they open it up. We go and sit down after we had grabbed a bite to eat, and I'm just sitting across the table from this guy, and I'd known a little bit about his story because somebody had introduced me to him. That basically he was living at home with his wife and his kids, but he was living in another bedroom. His wife hadn't kicked him out of the house, but she had asked him to go live in another bedroom because he was having an affair with another lady that he worked with. And the wife was wanting him to make a decision. Are you going to go be with her? Or are you going to stay home and be with us? That was breakfast. I was like, this ought to be pretty simple, you know? No, I have no clue what to tell somebody in a situation like that. And I've just learned, I trust my prayers far more than I trust my advice. And I've also learned no one wants to be told what to do. And so when I get in situations like that, I just end up asking a lot of questions. Hey, so tell me how you figured out, how'd your wife find out? How did you get into the situation you're in? How'd you meet her? What are you feeling right now? What are you thinking? And then about in the middle of it, I asked him this question that I didn't necessarily intend to ask him, but it broke open a whole lot of really great conversation. I said to him, I said, hey, how do you think God thinks about you right now? And his answer was made me laugh, but it was also so insightful. And I would imagine a lot of you can relate to what he said. He said, you know that emoji, which I thought, okay, that's not what I thought was coming next. He said, you know that emoji that has the hand over the face? This one right here. I said, yeah, I know that emoji. He said, that's how I think God feels about me. And it made me sad, honestly. I could understand why he feels that way, though. In fact, a lot of you are in church today because you're hoping God won't feel this way about you, and maybe you feel like he has. But this is so normal. So many people think this is the way God feels about me. That he's just going, oh, get it together. You moron. You know better than this. What are you doing? Everything's like, you know, the sentence, comma, idiot. See, I was reminded that day, like I've been reminded, just like you've been reminded numerous times, that without a proper view of the Father, we'll always be tempted to run away from home. Without a proper view of the Father, we'll always be tempted to run away from home. And when we miss the Father's heart, we'll always end up away from home. When we miss the Father's heart, when we miss how he actually feels about us, of course we'll end up away from home. And so somehow, somewhere, this younger son had missed the way his dad actually thought and felt about him. We see it in this next scene. Luke 15, verse 17, the story continues. When he came to his senses, which doesn't necessarily mean a heart change, it just may mean he didn't have anywhere else to go. But when he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. And so he had an idea, which was a very legitimate, great idea. He said, I will set out and I'll go back to my father and I will say to him. And then he writes this speech. And I want us to spend a few minutes looking at his speech, because I think inside of his speech, every one of us can relate to some feelings that it might be conjecture on my part, but I would imagine you could relate to some of the feelings that maybe he was having based on the speech that he was writing on what he was going to say to his dad. He started with this. He said, Father, I have sinned against heaven and I've sinned against you. This is a really great statement. He's saying, Father, I have sinned against heaven and I've sinned against you. This is consistent with what King David wrote in Psalm 51 after he had slept with Bathsheba, got her pregnant, brought her husband Uriah in from the battle and had him killed. He writes in Psalm 51, verse 4, against you, God, have I sinned. And so this younger son is saying the same thing. Yes, Dad, I've sinned against you, but I've also sinned against heaven, that there is this standard of right and wrong in the world. And somehow I have broken it willfully or even non-willfully. The things that I wish I had done, I hadn't done. The things that I wish I didn't do, I had done. And I regret it. I wish it hadn't been that way. I have sinned against you and I've sinned against heaven. And our natural response would be, well, therefore God feels what? He feels anger. He's mad. He's frustrated. He's upset. And maybe you felt that way. Maybe that's kept you from coming back home. Maybe he thought he's gonna be mad and I don't wanna face his anger. Maybe you've thought, yeah, God's gonna be mad and I don't wanna face that. Maybe you had an earthly father that every time his response to anything wrong you had done was more anger, shaking his finger, saying, how dare you? You better not. I'll give you one more chance, but if you do it again, it's over. And maybe that's the way you view God. He continues, he says, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. You see him opening up the door to shame, to embarrassment. And maybe that's what he thought. Maybe he thought, you know what? I had the kind of parent that whenever I did something wrong, it was always, hey, don't shame our family name. I've heard it said, maybe you had a parent that cared more about the last name than your first name. That cared more about keeping up the perception of the way we look, the way we do it, the way we're supposed to be. And he had clearly been an embarrassment. I'm sure every event that his parents went to, every party they went to at work, I'm sure his dad, people would ask and say, hey, how's your son doing? Where's he been lately? And I'm sure some of them probably had friends that knew him that'd be like, Mom, you're not gonna believe what so-and-so's doing. Let me tell you where he's been lately. And then it gets back to the parents that they knew, that the friends knew, and now other people knew, and they wonder how many other people knew about this, and they walk around with shame and embarrassment, and maybe the son felt like that was going to drive the dad's response, that he's embarrassed of me, and I've lost the relationship. He's embarrassed of me, he's ashamed of me, and I should be ashamed of me. He continues with his speech. He says, I've sinned against heaven. I've sinned against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Just make me like one of your hired servants. Make me like one of your hired servants and I will work my way back in your good graces. Maybe some of you had a dad growing up that just, you couldn't please. No matter how much you did, no matter how good you did, no matter how great you did, you just couldn't please him. Maybe you had a mom that affected your view of the way you see God. You just couldn't please her. She was always correcting you. She was always on your case about stuff. And maybe the younger son felt that way. You know what? I can't go home. I gotta be ready because I just can't please him. And it's gonna be exhausting to try to work my way back in. I don't know why exactly we run. I think it has a lot to do with our view of dad. But I just know that when we run, a lot of the reason we don't come back is for the same reason, because of our perspective of what kind of father God is. That maybe we run because we have misconceptions of God, but maybe we stay away, maybe we don't come home because we have a misconception of God. And so Jesus says, he's telling this crowd, hey, you got the whole seat, you're only gonna need the edge of it because this is an amazing story, all right? And he tells them this part of the story. He says, let me tell you what the Father is actually like. And this is the part of the story that is so emotional. The son finally decides, okay, I'm gonna get up and I'm gonna go. So he got up and he went to his father. And I love these next words. But while he was still a long way off, that while he was still a long way off, meaning this dad had been waiting, this dad had been hoping. This dad got up every day looking down the road going, is he here? He probably asked around, hey, you haven't heard anything yet. I mean, have we checked all the rooms? He didn't come home last night, did he? He probably went out to the fields to check on people, kept one eye on the road, making sure, can I see him? This dad turned, shut everything down at night, probably left that front light on the porch. Everybody's going, turn the lights off. Dad, what are you doing? No, I'm keeping them on. Because tonight might be the night. How's the weather looking for tonight? Are we looking like good weather? Oh, it's gonna rain? Okay, maybe tonight's not the night. Oh, it's not gonna rain? Maybe tonight's gonna be the night. Maybe tonight's the night he comes home. To the point where everybody probably went, oh my goodness, this guy's lost it. A lot of you, maybe to a fault, listen to a parable like this and you apply it to your own parenting. But you gotta remember, Jesus was not giving parenting advice here. Jesus is telling us what the Father is like. And the Father kept a light on and he kept an eye on the road. And while he was a long way off, look at what happened next. While he was a long way off, his Father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. Now, if we took out this word compassion, if you were to just read it and say, well, he was a long way off, the Father saw him and was filled with what? I mean, what would you assume that he would be filled with? Anger, disdain, frustration, jealousy maybe? Maybe he just was completely dismissive, full of contempt. Who knows what he was feeling? Anything but compassion. But he saw the Son returning home to the Father. And while he was a long way off, the Father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. And then he did something that no one would do in this day. In fact, if you were to see a grown man running in this culture, you would have thought that dude's being chased by the cops. That's the only reason why someone would have run in that day, especially not a grown man. But in this story, look at what happened. While he was still a long way off, his Father saw him and was filled with compassion for him, and he ran to his Son. Think about what he was wearing. He was wearing some kind of tunic, which meant that he had to hike up his skirt to run after his Son. You didn't do that in that day. But this Father did, because he was so excited to see his Son. He pulled up his tunic and he took off running. And then when he got there, he wrapped his arms around his Son and he hugged him and he kissed him. I'm sure his Son was like, what is going on? Some of you have kids that are old enough to where they're embarrassed when you kiss them and hug them in public. And my kids are just now getting to that age, which is so heartbreaking, you know? The other day, one of our kids was at their sports practice and I gave him a big hug before the practice and I kissed him and said, I love you, you're gonna do great. And they said, Dad, stop. And I was like, okay, I won't do that anymore in front of your friends, but when your friends aren't around, I'm gonna hug you and kiss you as much as I can because I want you to know how I feel about you. I'm not going to intentionally embarrass you, but if they happen to see, I just wanna apologize up front. I can't contain my love for you. And that's the way this Father said. He ran after the Son and he wrapped his arms around him and he kissed him. And the Son was probably thinking, oh my goodness, this is awkward. I better jump into my speech. And so he did. He's like, whoa, Dad. The Son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. It should have said ... because he wasn't done. And the Father didn't even let him finish his speech. But the Father said to all of his servants, quick, bring the best robe, put it on him. Bring a ring, put it on his finger. Bring the sandals and put it on his feet. Put the robe around him to let him know he's under our provision again. Put the ring on his finger to let him know he's still part of the family. And put the sandals on him because his feet were probably disgusting from the trip. And then he said, and bring that fattened calf that we've been holding for the special, most amazing occasion. And let's kill the fattened calf and let's have a feast and let's celebrate. Why? Why are we celebrating? You haven't even heard where he's been, what he's done. He's got to work his way back in. If you think this dad is crazy, you're going to love the older brother, and you can't miss next week. Because the older brother, a lot of you read the story and you're like, there aren't any sane people in the story except this older brother. And some of you can really relate to him, and you cannot miss it next week. Because we're going to talk about the only rational one in the story that was like, this is a little absurd. So if you feel that way, next week's for you. Why was he throwing a party? Why was he so excited? Because this son of mine was dead, and now he's alive. He was lost, and now he's found. And so they began to celebrate. They threw the biggest party you could imagine. When I lost this drone, it was embarrassing enough. It was hard enough to, you know, feel like such a lousy father. But what made me feel even worse is that the next, maybe 2 days later, I was up in the middle of the night thinking about it, going, how does this thing not have like a GPS thing, or does it not have a way to locate it? And so I went and found the instruction manual, and I started reading through the instruction manual, which actually would have been very convenient to do before I tried to fly the drone. And when I read the instruction manual, they talked about a button on the remote that they called the home button. And they said, all you have to do if the thing ever gets lost, just press the home button and it'll come right back to the remote. Some of you are thinking, well, why didn't you do that, comma, idiot? Well, because it was already dead. The battery's already dead. It was too late, all right? Plus, my in-laws had already bought our son a new one anyway. So anyway, that's a whole different deal, but... But when I read that, I'm not trying to tell you like, oh, the voice of God spoke to me through that instruction manual, because I don't know that God would even work that way. But I remember thinking, that is such a beautiful picture, though, of the way life works, that there's a home button. There's a home button. That at any point, at any time, whether you're one step out the door or whether you're all the way in the distant land thinking, man, ramen noodles would be amazing right now. Wherever you are, there's a home button. And all you have to do is push the home button. As simple as that is, as cliche as that might seem, the invitation that I would like to extend, the same invitation that this father extended to the son, is, would you just come back home? Would you understand the love of the Father? Would you allow yourself to experience the beauty of the love of the Father, and just know that you're welcome to come back home? See, a lot of you are out in a distant land. A lot of you are out there. You're in a season of life, and maybe you're thinking, I can't even believe I'm here today, and did he know, and did they design this way? We had no clue. I'm just walking through the passage. But some of you are there right now, and you're thinking, I don't even know, will he love me? He loves you. He never stopped loving you. He never will. Will he welcome me back home? He's already getting the party ready. In fact, he's paid for the party. Some of you, though, you're just one step out the door, and you can kind of see down the road, and you can already see kind of where this is headed. How amazing would the story have been if it was, there was a son who came to a father and said, Dad, I want all the possessions that are going to be mine when you die. And the dad says, hurts my feelings, son, but I'll do it, and gave him the money. And the son took about 5 steps out the door and realized, this is kind of silly. I'm just going to go back home. That would have been an amazing story. And for some of you, that can be your story today. Because when you see the Father for who he is, there's no reason not to move toward him. When you see him for who he is, that he is the provider, that he is a defender, that he is a father to the fatherless, that he is ultimately kind and gracious and full of mercy and full of love and full of justice, yes. But this is what's amazing, is that the only character that's missing from the story is the true older brother. There's an older brother in this story that's kind of the invisible behind the scenes. He's actually the one telling the story. See, Jesus did what a true older brother should have done, and Jesus went out looking for those of us who were lost. And when he When he found us, he paid our way back, and he sacrificed himself on a cross so that we could have a relationship with the Father. And so today, I just want to invite you, would you come back home? We're going to sing this song that says, "My heart needs a surgeon and my soul needs a friend. And so I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again and again." And I don't know what it looks like for you to come back home. Maybe it means just having a conversation with God. Maybe it means you need to turn around from the way you're headed. Maybe it means you need to tell somebody that you're headed in the wrong direction. But the invitation today is, would you come back home? Would you come back home? I'd love it if you would just close your eyes and bow your head. And sometimes there's moments in life where you need to actually do something physical to remind yourself of what is really true in your heart. And so as bold or maybe as courageous as this is, nobody's looking around any of our buildings. Would you be willing to say, hey, if you would like to accept the invitation to come back home, would you just raise your hand? Would you just put your hand in the air and say, this is me. I need to come back home. You might not be off in a distant land, but maybe you're headed there, and maybe you kind of know it and you don't like it and you wish it were different, but would you just hold your hand up in the air? That's awesome. Father, I just deeply believe that if we see you for who you are, there's no reason for us not to move toward you. And so I pray that today that countless hearts would do that, that they would move toward you in their heart. Thank you for being patient and waiting on us. God, you are so patient. You're so full of grace. You're so kind. It's your kindness that actually leads us to repentance. And so I pray today that every single heart that feels like they've taken a step outside of the home, that they would be willing to turn around and say, it's just better with the Father. It's just better with the Father. It's just better with the Father. God, thank you for Jesus. Thank you for the sacrifice he made so that we could be whole again, so that we could be in a relationship with you. That distance that we feel is just the difference between who you really are and the way we see you. And so I pray that today that you would close that distance with your grace and with your love as we turn around toward you. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.